Is the microphone on? Or? Yes, okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Warm welcome from Bangkok for the people who are not with us in the room and online. My name is Pierre Ferrand. I'm an agriculture officer and also the regional focal point for agroecology and UNDK, the family farming, in the regional office for Asia and the Pacific of FAO in Bangkok. I have the great pleasure
recording in progress
and honor to be moderating today's event, which will focus on the Coalition for Transforming Agri-Food Systems Through Agroecology. We have a very exciting and full program ahead of us for the hour to come to give us the opportunity to hear from ongoing and upcoming initiatives implemented at country level and led by either government or other important stakeholders to support the much needed transition toward more sustainable, resilient, inclusive and fair food system. So the side event today is organized around three parts. First, we will hear a little bit about the Agroecology Coalition and the progress that has been made in the implementation of the CFS policy recommendation. Then we will have we will hear about ongoing initiatives led by countries and by farmer organizations. And finally, we'll give the floor to three countries or region that are not member yet of the coalition to present a little bit what we are still doing for the promoting agroecology. But without further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Fergus Sinclair to take the floor and present the Agroecology Coalition. So Dr. Sinclair is a chief scientist at CIFOR IPRAF, is a co-convener of the Transformative Partnership Platform on Agroecology and one of the coordinators of the coalition. So Fergus, you have the floor and you have 10 minutes. I will display.
Okay, thank you, Pierre, and it's very nice to be mentioning agroecology during this event. I haven't heard it very much so far. Maybe we'll get more as things go on. Next slide. Now, the Agroecology Coalition really came up as a systematic response to the interconnected global challenges of broken food systems, climate change, land and water degradation, and catastrophic biodiversity loss. And because these things do interact so strongly, it's only systemic responses that are likely to be effective. And yet, we tend to have separate approaches to dealing with them rather than more integrated ones. Next slide. And the science now is getting really quite strong that it is the synergy, the interactions between these challenges that is where the problems arise. So if we look at the loss of insect abundance and diversity, it's the interaction between climate change and intensification of agriculture that really causes the problem, more so in the tropics than in temperate conditions. And we're looking at about a 50% reduction in abundance and 27% loss of species, which is a really serious issue in terms of those interactions playing out. And we could take other examples across those four challenges. Next slide. Now, the coalition started in the United Nations Food Systems Summit last year when the group of Friends of Agroecology managed to persuade Agnes Kalibata to put a session into the pre-summit. It was at a lunchtime because it was at the last minute. One of the best attended sessions of the entire pre-summit. And that led to the coalition being formed within the context of the summit. But there was also some issues. Civil society, a lot of civil society organizations had boycotted the summit because they didn't feel that it was really addressing their agenda and was somewhat top down in the way that it was organized. And so we're hoping as we move beyond the summit that we get a broader involvement. And the Transformative Partnership Platform on Agroecology has acted as an interim secretariat in order to enable the coalition to get started and to function. Next slide. So the basis of the coalition are the 13 principles of agroecology articulated in the high-level panel of experts report from the Committee on World Food Security in 2019. And the importance, principles are explicit statements that can guide thought and action. And they incorporate the 10 elements that you may be familiar with from FAO, but they're explicit in relation to a generic framing. But when they are locally applied, using the co-creation and sharing of knowledge principle, you end up with a diversity of practice. So it's not prescriptive in terms of practice, but it is in terms of the guiding principles about how we should approach agriculture and food systems. And the principles are as much to do with the governance and trade and socioeconomic aspects, fairness in the way that food systems are organized, agency and democracy within food systems, as with the agro-ecosystem management aspects in terms of soil health and animal health and the interactions and managing those interactions. As an explicit set of principles, they are always under scrutiny, and we're thinking and working with them. And so there are some revisions going on in relation perhaps to the articulation of input reduction. Revision to incorporate water, fish, and aquatic foods more fully within them, and nesting principles so we can present a smaller number of clusters that are a bit easier to get your mind around. Next slide. So the evidence is really gaining ground. This paper in Nature Sustainability this year shows very clearly how the use of crop diversification together with legumes can substitute for inorganic nitrogen fertilization. And that's from a massive range of data, 30 trials, each at least with 9 years of data across Africa and Europe. Next slide. And a review, an evidence review on the impact of agroecological practices on food security and nutrition. It was actually derived from the HLP report that involved further work by a group of some of the co-authors of the report. And it shows two things which are really important. One is that in most cases where agroecology has been adopted, there is an improvement in, a demonstrable improvement in food security and nutrition over 78% of cases. But also that the improvements are enhanced if you've got greater complexity. So the more of the practices taken on board, the bigger the level of transformation, then the greater the impact. Next slide. So the coalition has now nearly 40 members, 36 countries plus three regional bodies, the European Union, the African Union, and ECOWAS. Six countries from Asia, and about nearly 80 organizations, including key UN organizations, as well as civil society, farmers' organizations. A really huge element. And of course, the critical thing is a coalition of the willing. Now, you might have noticed that the recommendations in the HLPE report got quite considerably watered down in the policy recommendations because you had to get agreement across a large number of countries. And what we can do with a coalition of the willing is to be leading forward with those people who are happy to take things forward rather than waiting for everybody to agree on something before you can take action. And then people will be able to follow that example as things happen. So I think it's a real step forward that we've got that happening, and it's very action-oriented. Next slide. The steering committee is a governance body, is made up of representatives from the different regions, in terms of country representation, from the different types of organizations, and so it's inclusive in terms of governance, not just the people appointed, but these people were chosen as representatives by those constituencies. Next slide. And it has five working groups at the moment that are actually doing things. So there's a policy working group, and that's already, you know, making statements in relation to Coronevia, for example, in UNFCCC. There's the research and innovation group, which is taking a transdisciplinary approach and looking at reconfiguration of the way in which research, education, and extension happen in order to foster agroecological transitions. Public and private investment has already started using a tool to look at the level of investment in agroecology across countries. And communication and advocacy has put forward a set of messages, which are just about to become approved and get out. And then, of course, cutting across all of these is implementation and actually getting things done on the ground. Next slide. One of the critical things is that we're recognizing that there are different transitions in different, depending on where you're starting from and where you're going to. Now, quite often the sort of Gleisman transition model, which was very much based on starting from an industrial agricultural starting point and moving to agroecology. In much of sub-Saharan Africa, say, you may be starting from quite a low input base, and it's an agroecological intensification that you're really looking for, not starting with an input reduction. So when we, next element, which will bring some people in, I hope. There they are. Because that initial framing was in relation to the agroecosystem. But once you bring in the connectivity between producers and consumers, then agency becomes critical, and the extent to which people can express their preferences for how food is produced, and whether it's produced sustainably and equitably. Next slide. And I want to finish by drawing your attention to this approach that we're now taking to tracking the implementation of the CFS policy recommendations. And essentially, we boiled down the 63 or 62 specific recommendations in the policy recommendations down to 23 trackable items. We have a process and a protocol for then going through that with national partners in order to see what is being done, how it's connected, and then we will synthesize that in relation to progress with the HLP principles and the six dimensions of food security. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sinclair, for setting the scene and really introducing well our side event today. So now we are going to hear from two member countries of the Agroecology Coalition, which have national-level transformative initiative. So we'll also hear from two other organizations, one research institution, ICRAF, and one farm organization, AFA, who also have implemented some activities. So, first of all, I would like to invite His Excellency Dr. Chan Salut to present the Conservative Agriculture and Sustainable Intensification Consortium, CASIC in short, in Cambodia. So His Excellency currently serves as Undersecretary of State of the Ministry of Agriculture, Forestry and Fishery in Cambodia, and is the Chair of the Executive Board of CASIC.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for inviting me to join this side event. Also thanking the chair for organizing the agroecology side event, and also thank you Dr. Fungus, for your good presentation as well. So I would like to share our initiative we call the Conservation Agriculture and Sustainable Implementation Consortium. So it is kind that we try to apply this approach because at the moment there are so-called the obstacle that we face at the moment. So next slide, please. We talk a lot about the conservation agriculture and sustainable implementation. So far, even in Cambodia, we also introduced since 2004. However, due to the lack of the participation from the main actor, especially the private sector and all the stakeholders in the field of the conservation agriculture, and the to scale up is very slow. And to turn the conservation and sustainable implementation to the commercialized venture, so it's a need to bring all the actors to work together. So therefore, it is the need to establish the Cambodia Conservation Agriculture and Sustainable Implementation Consortium in order to bring all the actors to work together. So we call it CASIC. So CASIC is the bottom-up approach that bring all the actors to work together, or we can say in a short word that the win-win solution. So from the 2 days in this symposium on agri-food system transformation, I noted that it is required the relevant actor to work together. So next slide, please. So it is we also have clear vision that the well-established platform with a vast network of the organization that are working on the conservation agriculture issue as well as the agroecology. And our vision that we to establish the knowledge management and also relate to the resources for easy access for members, create an enabling an environment for the increase the investment in conservation, promote and enhance of the conservation agriculture practice, and strengthen collaboration between the stakeholders. So CASIC is not the implementing agency, but CASIC is the organization who try to provide support and coordinate with the all different actors. Next slide, please. And you can see from the structure of the CASIC, we have the two layers. The first layer we call the CASIC Steering Committee, and the second layer we call the CASIC Executive Board. So I'm the one who in charge for the executive board of this CASIC. Next slide, please. And it is very important to let you know that it is not it is easy to establish the CASIC. But when we establish it, it is very, very difficult to bring all the actors to work together. At the steering committee, we have called the 6+1+1. So where we need to bring 6 line ministry to work together, and also we have the one council for agriculture and rural development to work in that, and we also have representative from the private sector we call the Cambodia Chamber of Commerce. So they bring all the main actors at the national level to work, and then to convince them how they can support each other. Like we discussed in the last 2 days, we see that there are a lot of relevant activity that we need to support it together. At the executive board committee, we have 7+2+9+3. So 7 is mean 6 line department, 6 line technical department. We also have 2, the education, the agriculture new university, and 1 research institution. And we also have the provincial department involved in 9. Now we have also have 9 provincial department, and of course we need some the partner, like CIRAP is the friend international organization on agriculture, the Sweet Contact, and also the CSEN is the one who also provide the contribution support in place. So next slide, please. And below that, we also have the executive board, that we have four, the subcommittee called the knowledge management, coordination and networking, promotion and research for development. Next slide, please. And this is the systematic approach for the regenerative agriculture. So we also have the research center for excellence. As you know, we already have the 5-year strategic plan for development, the agroecology approach in Cambodia. We also the extension that we call the Metcasico is the, and also we have the like the skilled human resources. And of course, always we also have another one that we call the technology and practices. And now we are trying to introduce the, we call the golden soil, that we try to apply how we could encourage smallholders to work and also promote agroecology in Cambodia as well. Next slide, please. Since we established the CASIC in 2020, now we have several activities. And like the, we also have maybe in early next month, we also organize the regional the workshop on the regenerative agriculture as well. Also, is agroecology is also the one part that include in this the program as well. So the last slide, please. You can see. Even we start from the 2004, but we cannot scale up very widely. But you can see in 2019, when we start to establish the CASIC, now we can see the number of the conservation agriculture, the triple, the increase, because of the, we bring all the actors to work together and support to together. So as I would like to take this opportunity that to all the participants who attend this event to support and bring the message to the maybe the UN organization as well, to consider and to provide the agroecology financing, we call the agroecology incentive to agriculture producer who fully or partly apply the agroecology, especially smallholder farmer, in order to, you know, to because from my observation, there are a lot of benefit from the agroecology approach. So I would like to thank for giving me a chance to make this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Salut, for this very insightful presentation. Now we are going to move to Vietnam, and I would like to invite Ms. Pham Thi Anh Tho to present the Vietnamese Strategic National Action Plan for Responsible, Sustainable and Transparent Food System 2021-2030. Ms. Tho is the Vice Director of the Center for Agrarian System Research and Development under the Field Crop Research Institute of the Vietnam Academy of Agricultural Science. So Ms. Tho, over to you.
Kindly speak quite loud and close to the microphone.
Thank you very much, Pierre. And, excellencies, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to express my very much appreciation for FAO for organizing this event, so that we can have an opportunity to share our national action plan. Talking a bit about this action plan, actually we are going to finalize it, and it's expected that we will submit to the Prime Minister and to get the approval by the end of this year. So that means this national action plan was built up through different rounds of consultation. And again, this event is a very good opportunity that we can present with you and get the feedback from different guests, different members of the symposium. So before going into more detail about this NAP, National Action Plan, I would like to share with you some challenges that Vietnamese people are now facing. And I believe that is also the cross-cutting issue amongst our country in the region as well. As you might know that Vietnam is very famous with some exportation main products like rice, coffee. And also we improve a lot in terms of poverty and hunger reduction. However, we still have a lot of people living under the poverty line. And especially our production system are considered relatively not really sustainable because of overuse of chemical. And malnutrition, obesities are the double burdens of our strategies of food system transition. So in our five action tracks that our president stated in the food system summit last year, we define very clear five action tracks. First of all, we will ensure the access to the safe and nutritional balanced food for everyone. And second, we will transform our food system into a more sustainable, healthy way. And the third action track, we will promote environmentally friendly production. The fourth action track will be promoting equality in shared values and livelihoods. And finally, last but not least, we will build up the resilience to vulnerability and shock to everyone related in the system. And then, talking about the overall objectives, next please. As you can see from the screen that we have very big strategy for sustainable agriculture and rural development. And so that we put that as the key role, key goal of the food system transition in Vietnam, that we try to achieve. And we put very clear objective that by 2030, we will try to improve the level of transparency, responsibility, sustainability for the food system. And then we get along with the sustainable development goals that every country is now aiming at. We also so we have a specific objectives to get our five action tracks stated by the president of Vietnam. First, we will ensure that everyone has access to the healthy food and sustainable food. Saying that, we not only consider about the malnutrition, but also, especially in the rural area, but also the obesity and unhealthy diet in the urban area as well. Reducing loss and waste to promote the responsible and sustainable food consumption is our objective, second objective as well. And also, we promote the more transparent, responsible, and sustainable agriculture production so that we can contribute to the green growth strategy to reduce the gas emissions of the country. And we will develop the competitive, transparent value chains in the future. And finally, we strengthen the resilience for everyone who are related to value chain, especially value chain development, especially some groups are focused can be women, Jews, people, and disadvantaged group of the people who are living in isolated area or difficult condition. Next, please. And so we have a main task to do so. Firstly, for improve the good access for nutrition and education. I don't want to go into more detail about this because it's still in the draft version, but I just bring here two things that we want to achieve. We put two main tasks, firstly, to improve the healthy food access through different initiatives. And the most important initiatives that we state, we plan is that we will build up an innovation center of food, and we consider that the regional center for not only Vietnam but also for every country can be sharing and learning to each other. And we improve the food safety management system. And why we put food safety management system? Because we already achieved very much significant achievement in exportation, but monoculture, like overuse chemicals in our system, is still popular in Vietnam, and it leads to the consequence that consumers in Vietnam now, when we consume or when we buy most of the foods in the market, we are not sure about the food safety and quality. That's why we put the main task for our first objectives. For better consumption in the future, we put the food loss here to say that the food loss and food waste is not only in the consumption side, but also the processing and post-harvest stage. At the same time, we will promote the good practices in consumption, both in rural and urban areas. I just want to give you an example about the sad story that in the local rural area that we have a lot of indigenous local foods, but because of different reasons. Nowadays, the tradition of giving food, especially to children, is that we use instant noodles. It's very popular in the rural area now. So moving to the third task that we put in the National Action Plan is that we try to improve the production organization and management by improving the policies, improve the good practices of production, and especially we now in Vietnam we have a varieties option for production protocol and standards like Vietgap, like organic, even PGS organic or USDA or Global Gap, etc. Just organic. However, very small amount of the products in our country are produced under that certification and standards. So in the future, that bring to very important tasks that we have to achieve. Also, added value to agriculture and rural development is important task of our task as well, our NAP as well, because we consider agriculture is not a isolated sector in our economy, because nowadays we can bring so many value added to that section, and also we can bring that values of agriculture to tourism, to rural tourism, and also we can protect our culture and bring it into the comprehensive system. And agroecology can be the very efficient pathway to transfer our food system like that. For the fourth task, it's related to value chain development. And as a scientist in Vietnam, we are happy that value chain is the term appears in so many policy documents in Vietnamese government. However, we still need to cope lots of things in terms of infrastructure, in terms of post-harvest technology, digitalization, and especially linkages among stakeholders of the value chains. The last but not least is improve the resilience to people to be involved in the value chains and rural development. We need more responsible marketing model, not only focusing on the economic benefit or value, but also the social and environment benefits and value as well. And we put some keywords to resilience here is biodiversity improvement to ensure that not only monoculture appear in the region, but also diversity of varieties of options for farming system development as well. So thank you very much for your attention and happy to get your feedback.
Thank you very much, Ms. To, for sharing this ambitious and exciting national action plan for Vietnam. Now we are going to move online, and I would like to invite Professor Zhuanchu Xu. Can you hear us?
Yes.
Yes, very good. So Professor will present a case from China entitled "To Nature, Close to Nature, Agroforestry and Biotechnology." Dr. Chu is Principal Scientist of the World Agroforestry Center and Distinguished Professor at the Kunming Institute of Botany of the Chinese Academy of Science in Yunnan, China. And he is coordinating the Mountain Future Program, which is a global initiative to support knowledge innovation for smallholders in mountainous regions worldwide. So, Professor Chu, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Chair, and thanks for participants. My topic really look at how biodiversity and also biotechnology contribute to restore and also develop market value chain for agro-food system. So my presentation will be three parts. And the first talk about a challenge. If we look at the agro-food system, we have monoculture and lost the species. We have increased yield, but not increased income. And then we have increased greenhouse gas emission and also increased the environmental pollution from agriculture sector. Then how we transform agricultural system, we need to learn from our tradition. And if we look at the evolution for agriculture from hunting gathering, shifting cultivation, traditional agriculture, industrial agriculture, and then now we all call modern agriculture, but what the future agriculture looks like. Definitely we need to include more species, we need a smart, we need also to recycle and connect not only between human and human, but also human and nature. How are we going to do that? And if we look at the ecosystem from nature based, and then we found the combination of microbial plants, fungi, insects, and animal are five pillars basically support the environmental services and also the food production. So our task as agronomists, we need a connecting and the circular with different species. The circular means the output from all processes are input to other processes. So, which not only plant, but also animal, fungi, microbiums play a very important role. So, we illustrate how fungi to contribute into ecosystem functioning by supporting above and below ground interaction. So we suggest the circular agriculture start with a living germplasm collection, agroecology approach for innovation, agroforestry demonstration at a large scale, finally circular biotechnology development by conducting not only food chain but also industry production. How are we going to do that? That's one system we developed. We have inoculated CIFOR seedling for close to nature restoration. The CIFOR become not only valuable products for European market, also in Asia become popular. So we include different CIFOR species with different forestry species for restoration. Also, we manage different states of vegetation for different mushroom in the different stage. So that's agroecology play key role as fundamental sound, but also include the management practice. For restoration, with combination different species, one model we currently use, we have a common tree or couple as shade tree on the large scale. On top, we have a Phalanthus umbilica or amla in the middle. We have a new tribal plants called Calotropis yampia in the low, and then also we have legume as cover crop for improving the soil fertility. So the products based on fiber, we have couple tree and or cotton tree. We also have the Calotropis, which is commonly found in the tropic region. And that's the product we're developing with the coast area of China. We develop a high quality textile. And this year we're selling for 10 million Chinese yuan as new products into the market. The future biotechnology can contribute by new technology we call bio-based lizard and produce from incubator system by new fungi species. So that's, you can see left side, the new fiber from our industrial level. Now we expand the title into large scale for to replace the leather from animal skin. So in the future, the microbiome, particularly the fungi, can contribute to the new textile development. So agroecology and biotechnology application in large scale, which combine superior variety of new crops, new species, and microbiome, standard demonstrating site, vertical cropping, organic farming was from the circular biofertilizer. In past 5 years, we're developing 2 million hectare demonstration and in different scenarios. So in the remote mountain area, use Philanthus umbilica amla and the mining restoration, and also the shade coffee with a high standard rainforest announced certificate for European market. We install dry land and using mango garden and then by biofertilizer. So in short, we need to develop market value chain through the certain standard. So market increasingly recognize close to nature of the forage products for teas, for coffee, for amla products. You can find a different spectrum from single species, more or less close to nature, for this type of agriculture. So there's multiple benefit. I don't like to see and illustrate in the two details. There's a multiple benefit through this kind of system. So who play key role in the circular economy? It's basically mushroom, insects, livestock, fishery, which link production, circular agri-industry system, and the market value chain. So this is an example of a mushroom and the insects, how we're going to reduce the animal waste, particularly from livestock and from kitchen. So we have some recognition from local level by local government. We have production demonstration in North Korea, and then we have agreement with India and some extension to Africa. We get the best food practice recognized by South-South Collaboration Bond of FAO. So if you like to learn more system, how we going to build what's innovation, come to our new journal called Circle of Agriculture Systems. So, we have platform Command and Future, which provides a systematic innovation and a solution for rural smallholder farmers. So thank you. Welcome to Command and Future.
Thank you very much, Professor Xu, for this very insightful presentation and amazing work that you are doing in South China. Finally, I would like to invite now Ms. Esther Pinunia to present the Million Voice Initiative. So Ms. Pinunia is the Secretary General of the Asia Pharma Association for Sustainable Rural Development, AFA in short. And AFA is an alliance of 22 national pharma organizations in 16 Asian countries with around 13 million small-scale women, men and young farmers as members. Esther, over to you.
Thank you very much, Peter, and good afternoon, good morning to all participants, depending on your location at the moment. I would like to share with you the 1 Million Voices Initiative, a citizen science project for agroecology. This is a project conceived by members of the Transformative Partnership Platform on Agroecology, which Fergus presented earlier. And in this transformative platform, APA, or our organization, Asian Farmers Association for Sustainable Rural Development, is a steering committee member. Next slide, please. When at the TPPAE, one steering committee member expressed the idea of a citizen science project. We became interested, especially because of the term, as it denotes, some principles that we adhere, that farmers are scientists. So we Googled what is citizen science, and from the Google, we learned that scientific research, that this is scientific research conducted in whole or in part by ordinary citizens of all ages, often in collaboration with or under the direction of professional scientists and scientific institutions, and working together to answer real-world questions, generate new knowledge for an evidence-based policy advocacy and awareness campaign. Next slide. So, previous slide, please. So we had consultations also with some people doing already citizen science project, and one very interesting example that we heard was the research entitled Proof in Underpants, done by Swiss researchers from the University of Zurich, where researchers are sending thousands of pairs of white cotton underwears to volunteers who will bury them in their gardens. And the purpose of this research is to measure soil health. And then the volunteers will later dig up the underpants, analyze them with the researchers, look at the extent by which tiny organisms in the earth have eaten away the fabric, and look at this picture on the right. And the aim is to raise awareness on soil erosion and soil health. On soil health, because the theory is the more worn, the more eaten the underwear is, the more microorganisms there are in the soil, and therefore the soil is healthier. So with this, we understand that citizen science is democratic, is participatory, and involves action, which is very much part of the principles of APA with regards to research and innovation. Next slide, please. The 1 Million Voices Initiative is an effort to do citizen science to support farmers' transition to agroecology. This initiative was launched during the UN Food System Summit, but this is independent of its processes. It aims to give a voice to small-scale farmers who practice agroecology in their own way, and to consumers who are committed to sustainable and equitable systems to participate in defining national food system transition pathways. Big data in agri-food systems transformation make family farmers miss big data. The 1 Million Voices Initiative would like this endeavor to increase the agency of family farmers, especially smallholder farmers, as well as farm workers, women, indigenous peoples, and food consumers from all backgrounds. Next slide, please. So what is the initiative in Asia? Because this initiative covers three continents, in Africa, in Latin America, and in Asia. Right now, we are in the co-design stage for all the three continents, and the output of this co-design phase are broad strokes and agreements, including ways forward for a citizen science project to include key elements such as the collective goal, purpose, priority themes, and methodologies. After the co-design stage, hopefully by next year, will be the implementation stage. Next slide, please. So how is the co-design stage being done in Asia? We had first an in-person session where we had 90 two participants from 13 countries in Southeast Asia and in South and Central Asia. Next slide, please. So we ask, our participants in this in-person workshop that was held in Bangkok. We ask them what are their current involvement with citizen science. And we were happy to know that some of them are already doing this. Like in India, 24,000 cotton farmers are involved in a research on production and water management in cotton plantations by sending their voice messages to the research team. As well as in Nepal, farmers inform research team about farming methods and impact of climate change to them. The findings were used for the drafting of the climate resilient land use plan in Nepal. We asked them also about the topics that the initial thoughts on 1 million voices initiative in Asia. And these are things that were mentioned. With regards to the topic, it should be on climate change and environmental crisis. Can we have the next slide, please? The initial thoughts will be on climate change and environmental crisis through farmers produce evidence. This can be on changing weather patterns, precipitation rate, natural disasters, climate impacts on farmers, as well as adaptation to agroecology. Next slide, please. In terms of purpose, the purpose of the citizen science project on agroecology can involve the creation of can aim to create public data to help farmers better prepare and adapt to climate change, preserve and promote farmers' knowledge, generate information and knowledge that can scale up agroecology, as well as capture the attention of policymakers and financing institutions on farmers' needs and challenge others to adapt to climate change. It's like this. In terms of data collection method, smartphone, and these are the initial thoughts, smartphone to send pictures, descriptions, voice messages, and video clips to the researchers. However, many of the farmers still have difficulties in using their devices, as well as there is poor internet connection in remote areas, so citizen science project should be able to address these concerns. Also, it must be done in local languages, and all instructions about data collection and analysis must be short and easy to understand, otherwise farmers would refuse to take part. Next slide, please. So what will be the next step for the 1 million boys in agroecology in Asia? So we have all these thoughts collected, but we want further consultations with other farmers groups. So on October 20, we will have an APA General Assembly where we will meet all of our members and discuss further thought within at 7 Pacific Regional Farmers Forum on October 26-27. We will be able to also get some of inputs on them. After that, we will consolidate the inputs and still have further consultations with partner regional research institutions and NGOs. And after that, based on combining the consultations from the farmers organizations and research institutions and NGOs, we hope to have a zero draft of the OMB by December 2022. And with this, I would like to end as a call to participate. We hope that you could participate in Asia. I would like to ask the host to play this video, a song, 7 seconds, by a very popular Sinhalese singer, used to endure.
And when a child is born into this world, he has no concept of the tone of skin is living in a million voices.
Tell you what you should be thinking, so you never sober up.
One Million Voice Initiative in Agroecology, and hope you could participate in this. We will inform you of the developments of this initiative, because we really want 1 million voices in this citizens' violence project. Thank you very much, and happy New Year.
Thank you, Ms. Penunia, for introducing this very innovative approach to broaden the support to the much needed agroecological transitions. It's really great to hear. We are running a bit late, but we are entering the final part of our session, so stay with us. We'll be hearing from a representative of three countries or region who are not members of the Agroecology Coalition, but they have already engaged in some really interesting initiative at national level. So first, I would like to invite Ms. Sapnam Shivakoti to share what Nepal has been doing in regards to agroecology and a comment regarding the coalition. So Ms. Shivakoti is a joint secretary under the Ministry of Agriculture and Livestock Development of Nepal. She's also the focal point for family farming and for the International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture in the country. Over to you, Ms. Sapnam. We can't hear you. Are you muted? Yes. Ms. Sapnam, you need to unmute. Ah, yeah, okay.
Hello. Yeah.
Yes, very good. Over to you. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, thank you, FAO, for giving this opportunity to share about what Nepal is doing and regarding the agro-ecosystem, agroecology, the transport and food system in Nepal. So I'll be sharing of the ongoing initiatives briefly. Next. Oh, okay. So I will just briefly touch upon that what has been the major challenges regarding the food system transformation. I'll not touch upon our work, but mostly from the ecological perspective. As we are all aware that Nepal is very highly vulnerable to natural disasters and climate change impacts. So because of that, there has been several changes in the precipitation pattern, droughts, some climatic factors, and as well as there's a lot of soil wash every year because of the landslide and other erosion. Similarly, there are new pests and diseases, and the severity of pests increasing. Farming system, the resilience has been affected, and the production domains have been affected. Similarly, the extreme event has also resulted into a threat to the loss of biodiversity, negatively impacting the food and nutrition security. There has been declining agroecosystem services, although not very intensive studies done, but then some of the indicative studies have shown that because of the changes in the flora and food supplies of those pollinators, for example, and there is a change in their population is declining. Similarly, with the changes in agricultural and other various features, there has been change in the farm system. There has been increased use of the pesticides and fertilizers. The sustainable, unsustainable cultivation practices. Similarly, there are cases of the land degradation. The traditional farming system has now shifted to monocropping. Farm animal holdings are declining, which used to contribute to the farmyard manure in the soils. So a lot of these anthropogenic and climate change patterns have negatively impacted the agroecosystem as a whole. So if we look at the major implication of this has been definitely on the production and profitability. The cost of cultivation is higher. Agriculture is not more attractive to the majority of the farmers. So they are shifting away from the agriculture. They have an increasing trend of the migration, due to which almost 30% of the cultivated land in high hills and mountains have remained fallow. They have been abandoned. Similarly, there is growing feminization of agriculture. And because of all these, the food security has been threatened, not just from the self-sufficiency perspective, but also because there has been growing dependency on the agriculture inputs. Well, our earlier agriculture was more sustainable, but now the dependency on the external inputs, be it fertilizer, be it hybrid seeds, so all these are making our food security and the farming system very vulnerable. And as a result of this, there has been continuously the agriculture trade deficit rising, which has been very serious concern for Nepal. And therefore, the need, this emphasizes the need for sustainable agricultural production and therefore the emphasis on agroecology restoration. There are the policy and programs that are that considers the agroecology as its to its center. As Nepal has been parties to various treaties and instruments and commitments, so based on that, Nepal has also defined and designed various policies and programs. And there is the Right to Food and Food Sovereignty Act. We have agro-biodiversity policy. Similarly, biodiversity strategy plan of actions is there. There's climate change policy and nationally determined commitments, and which has also emphasized the soil organic matter replenishment. Similarly, the recent initiative that International Food Systems Summit was held, after that Nepal has also developed pathways for Nepal, and these pathways have also recognized the importance of agroecological interventions. If you look at the ongoing initiatives, there has been initiatives in agro-ecosystem service management as well as in the promotion and strengthening adaptive capacity of the local communities. So they have been implementing the integrated pest management with the conservation of the natural enemies, use of the bio and botanical pesticide, etc. Similarly, they have fungal manual improvement, conservation agriculture, crop diversification. They have also emphasized on organic and ecological agriculture, good agriculture practices and good husbandry practices, among others. Similarly, in terms of promotion and strengthening capacity, they have supported the policy and the programs have been supported to agro-biodiversity management, the emphasis of the nutrient dense and climate resilient crops that are more that favors the ecological restoration. And also the awareness campaigns on the importance of agro-ecosystem services. Although more priority is needed in this area because this has been still less prioritized, I would say. Similarly, there was Agro-Ecosystem Farmers Field School and demonstrations were held. This I would particularly like to refer here to the FAO-TCP project on agroecology, which focused on three districts of the major agroecological region of the country and studied the agroecosystem changes and also developed some interventions that was in favor of the agroecosystem. I think that there are supports and subsidies programs and there is training exposures and other social capital building. Some recent initiative that I would like to say that particularly favors agroecological promotion is that Nepal announced this current fiscal year of Nepal, 2022-23, as the biodiversity year for Nepal. So we have defined different programs for this year. And I would particularly like to mention here about the celebrating agro-biodiversity day because although there is an international agro-biodiversity day celebrated, but there is one particular day in Nepal where this has both regional and religious and cultural significance. And we have announced that as the agro-biodiversity day, so that should be marked as agro-biodiversity day every year from this year onwards. And this is particularly to recognize the importance of agroecology when we talk about the agro-biodiversity, to bring more awareness among the implementers, among the policy makers, and also the media persons. So this will highlight the importance and the need of the agro-ecological promotion also. And I would like to refer here to the National Pathways for Food System Transformation following this International Food System Summit. And particularly in the action third, the boosting nature positive production of the FFS, this has focused on the agro-ecosystem-based resilient planning and revitalization of indigenous food systems and also to make concerted efforts on conserving and utilizing the biodiversity. So basically on this one, we recently did this on the 13th of September this year, we had a national dialogue which focused on detailed action plan because the action tracks were identified, but because there was no defined detailed action plan, it was very difficult to implement those action tracks into action. So, in the lead of national planning commissions, we are formulating, still not finalized, the detailed action plans, so that this will be integrated into the annual programs of all three tiers of the government and other development partners for the next fiscal year. Similarly, we are also planning the conference on agroecology. That was earlier planned in October, but because since the government announced the local election, the national election on this early December, early November, so we'll announce the new date, and then definitely this will be shared with this agroecological coalition also, so that some of you can participate or share your presentations during the conference. And my further emphasis that is needed, if we look at from our country's perspective, is because improving ecosystem through further enhancement of agrobiodiversity conservation and management is very critical. Similarly, enhancing capacity at various levels. We are three tiers of the government, at federal, provincial, local levels. So the capacity in terms of their understanding, to design, to implement, to monitor and evaluate the ecosystem management is very important. So this, I think this is should be a continuous effort. And similarly, improving the resilience of local communities and enhancing the capacity is equally important. And then also engaging the private sector. Research and studies, which is, I think, is need to be more emphasized,
yes.
Especially in the climate change impacts on agriculture and agro-ecosystem service-related research and studies. So what has been the diversity and population changes, what is the perspective of the farmers, and how we can best intervene these. And similarly, on the study of the policy, institution and capacity gaps for mainstreaming agro-ecosystem in government policies and plans. This is very critical because when we formulate policies, the policy emphasizes on one particular sector or subsectors, and then this integration of these agro-ecosystems is also equally important. And use of ICTs for agro-ecosystem-based approaches is equally important. And training and exposures is definitely required. And of course, this platform that we have hearing about the coalition, and this first presentation also, and then how we can best collaborate and coordinate with these regional platforms. This is also very, very important, and I think Nepal would also be after getting the after we heard about how other countries are doing after the engagement in the coalition. So probably Nepal would also be interested to join in this coalition, and we will have a consultation back home about this. With that, I'll end my presentation here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Adnan, for sharing all the initiative happening in Nepal, and we can see that there are plenty. So now we are going to change completely of geographic area, because I would like to invite Ms. Alice Tuka to present the situation in the Pacific. So Ms. Tuka is a food system program lead at the Pacific Community, based in Suva, Fiji. And SPC is an international development organization governed by 27 members, including 22 Pacific Island countries and territories.
Thank you and good afternoon. I know it's a long stretch we're about to head off, and being the last speaker is always a challenge. But thank you for staying, and thank you to Pierre and to FAO for extending an invitation to be part of this panel this afternoon. I'm mindful of the time, so I won't really go on for too long. And plus, I think I've perceived this, I had seen this coming, so I've got only two slides, more to something to look at if you don't want to listen to me talking. So I think Pierre has already introduced SPC, but I'll just quickly talk a bit about more that, about the organization, just give some context. And then just very briefly at the end, share about our journey on agroecological transformation, and specifically how it links to food system approaches, which is something we've taken on in a big way this year. As Pierre mentioned, SPC is a regional organization and a fairly big one in terms of Pacific context. We have 27 members, of which 22 are Pacific Island countries and territories, and 5 are metropolitan members. So that includes Australia, New Zealand, and the EU, for example. We're a proud partner with our member countries and territories on this food systems journey, and it's one that's taken a number of years. And really culminating this year with establishing a food systems program. As the Pacific's own scientific and technical organization, SPC brings research and expertise in multiple areas related to food production, consumption, trade, and policy, to name a few. An integrated programming in SPC, particularly food systems, is, and you've heard that yesterday and this morning during the Pacific session, is grounded in culture, gender, social inclusion, rights-based methodologies, data and evidence, and monitoring and evaluation and learning. It connects also to other cutting-edge initiatives. We call it cutting-edge in the Pacific because we've got three prominent ones in our organization. One is the Pacific Community Center for Ocean Science, which we call PCOS. The other one is called the Pacific Data Hub. Some of you might have heard of it. But I think the last one is probably a significant one, and probably a lot more well-known in the agriculture space, which is our Pacific Center for Crops and Trees, CPACT, which is really our genetic resources bank. And all these key regional public goods, we call them, and centers of expertise really is an opportunity to leverage the interdisciplinary expertise that's within the organization and to leverage to support our members in the countries. Within the global food system, I think the Pacific is in a unique position, unique in that around 50 to 70% of our people really rely on the ocean and the land for their livelihoods. And over 50% of, if you're not aware, over 50% of the global catch of tuna comes from the region's sustainably managed tuna resources. And in terms of crop diversity, CPACT, which is our Center for Pacific Trees, houses over 2,000 extensions of the region's staple crops, so from sweet potato to yam, breadfruit, and so on. And the taro collection, particularly, is the largest collection of taro diversity globally, with over 1,000 extensions. The Pacific region is also in a unique position, given the, despite the proximity to land and the ocean, and you've heard that again over the last 2 days, is the region faces high levels of disease, premature death, and disability. And NCDs, scarily, accounts for over 70% of our deaths in the region. I think the Honorable Secretary from Micronesia yesterday reflected on this. And a lot of these problems are linked to challenges in maintaining adequate diets and comes from the deficiencies in our food system. Last year, our members, all 27 of them, endorsed food systems as a core program and particularly a key focus area in our new strategic plan, which was launched in October last year. And the key focus area was really to guide our interventions and to support our members. And recognizing the challenges, but it was really to put a positive spin to things, try to, and to make us celebrate what Pacific Food Systems is all about. And I think fundamentally founded on three things. One is food is a part of Pacific identities, cultures and economies, and particularly coastal food systems, so linking land and the ocean, how this underpins this. And I think a lot of that links to a lot of the agroecological work, biodiversity, so really fundamental to the work we're doing in the Pacific. Secondly is the Pacific Ocean. We are big Pacific ocean states, so the Pacific Ocean is really at the heart of not just the regional global food system, but we would like to think also the global food system. And finally, that we have sustainable stewardship of food systems, and particularly when we talk about the environment, biodiversity, climate change, and sustainable agriculture. Again, referring to a minister yesterday from Samoa particularly, who reinforced the messages about us, you know, shouldering responsibility and playing our part. But again, also recognizing the issues that continue to confront us, food imports reliance, which again has been mentioned several times, but demographic changes and migration, a lot of movements from the rural to the urban centers, non-communicable diseases, and of course COVID-19, but more so climate change and eroding resource base in the Pacific. I was listening to the BBC the other morning, and I think it was Martin Ifad who said, we're going through a convergence of crisis, and I noted that, and I was like, that's a good thing to use in, when we're talking about food systems and the challenges that's confronting us. It's really a convergence of crisis. SPC, the organization I work for, has produced a series of evidence briefs on Pacific food systems. So I have these around here, so I've brought some along. So really, these document the national food system pathways, which I think a lot of the speakers throughout the 2 days have referenced. And this really is to just reinforce the messages for SPC, but for us to find ways in which to help our member countries. And just lastly, as I bring this to an end, is really to just quickly share about an SPC initiative, which is the CIFOR initiative. And I think this shows how the 13 principles of agroecology underpins food systems conversations in our region. And our team in the SPC, particularly the Land Resources Division, are working on organic learning farms, for example. This project started last year and it goes till 2025. And is in two phases. So phase one is working to establish learning farms in four countries. That's Tonga, Nauru, Fiji, and the Solomon Islands, using agroecological practices, so a lot of organic green composting, for example, and agroforestry practices, essentially sustainable agriculture. Built in this project is capacity building, which is really fundamental for the sustainability of community and national level, but also builds a cohort of people within the Pacific, well, in the countries, but I think more broadly across the sub-regions and the region. And I think one of the interesting parts of this project is that it includes non-state actors, so private sector and civil society, at core and upfront partners in this initiative. Phase two will be about having demonstration sites, and I think they're looking at about 40 to 100 farms, depending on the size of the country. So Nauru, in this case, will probably look at only about 40 farms, whereas the bigger economies, Fiji and Solomon's, more, probably 100 to more than 100 farms. And key here is the integrated components, particularly water and energy nexus, and the other capabilities from across the SBC divisions, which includes genetic resources, markets and livelihoods, natural resource management and sustainable agriculture. As I mentioned, the project doesn't conclude in 2025, so I think each year we'll be taking on lessons learned and something that we'll be quite happy to share in various platforms in the future. So I'll conclude there and be happy to take any questions, and I'll be around in the next few days.
Thank you very much, Ms. Tuka, for bringing the Pacific perspective into our event and this discussion. Finally, we are going to move back to India, where I would like to invite Mr. Muralidhar Ganduri to share the perspective from Andhra Pradesh in India. So Mr. Muralidhar is a co-lead in the Andhra Pradesh Community Managed Natural Farming. He's also the co-founder and advisor of the National Coalition for Natural Farming in India. Mr. Muralidhar, over to you. Can you hear us? Yes?
Yes, please.
Perfect.
Good afternoon. All of you. I am representing Andhra Pradesh, India, where a million farmers and farm worker families are on the journey of natural farming. And we are going towards reaching to about more than 5 million in the next 10 years. The issue we are able to transcend is the natural farming agroecology principles, technology and production. But what is grappling is with the taking it to more people with ease. The behavioral game issue, the long term issue, ecosystem has to change. We are struggling with that. With the supplementation of the pre monsoon dysoing and specifically the green cover with multi layer, multi crops throughout the year, natural farming seems to have completed the loop. So, what we need to go forward, we realize that microbes are forming. And women and men are helping them to do better. The issues to in our system, we are able to see that just practitioners, key farmers, champion farmers are able to talk not just the professionals but the farmers themselves who are doing well are talking to them. Then local models are customized and available to the farmers. Women groups and villages take charge of mobilization, acting, and taking charge. Fourth, we have come with women mediated dissemination systems in multiple ways. And the fifth is government has turned around from being a naysayer to double chance to now they are saying natural farming is good. So there is a turnaround is happening. So as a result, there seems to be some progress on large-scale eruption with some case. The trigger seems to be that we have consumption. Trigger seems to be temple, inner bodies, mother and child, and schools taking natural farming food. And trigger seems to be farmers getting fair share in the value chain. And local enterprises and local collective enterprises, farmers taking charge of value chains and some work on the linkages. But work on the consumers needs to be still done so that the demand is much higher. Consumer behavior change for good in favor of the natural farm produce consumption. We are working towards AP evolving as a model state for the states in the country to follow. So that is one direction. we are able to see that we become a national resource organization in the country, and therefore national mission on natural farming is emerging. The Niti Aayog of the MP, Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Rural Development are saying, let us have a national mission on natural farming. So that is a big step forward. We are in the country, India is committed to moving to 20% farm panchayat and 10,000 farmers in the coming 5 years. We are able to partner with other states so that they can take up, look at and learn the lesson from scratch. We can build on what Agri Pradesh has started. We are able to work with civil society organizations, national coalition for natural farming has emerged with a network which is able to build the work in the other states. Then we are able to build some partnerships with the government to be a technical support, partnerships with pushing the agenda is happening. Government, the Indian Council for Agriculture Research is able to partner with us to say that they are totally reluctant. Today they are saying we will partner with us, let us understand more. So that is another important development. And we are able to think about, not think about, we started in July, the Indo-German Global Academy for Agroecology Research in Dublin to take the agroecology research to the farmers and take it from the farmers and give it to them. The state give it to them. So there is a work is going on. We are building more than 10,000 farmer scientists and about 100,000 trainers who will take agroecology, natural farming, agenda forward. We are also able to think about community-centered digital platforms emerging, and we are able to for learning for managers. And we are also able to see global master classes, digital master classes happening for interested people coming. We are able to transform the natural farming-based, agroecology-based food system to become a reality rather than a mere vision. I think this is the direction, and we are AP and India are moving in the direction. We need all the help. The coalition, Agroecology Coalition, at the global level will be useful. We are already in partnership with Kargis and his team in the craft. So these partners will take a forward idea. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mohalgar, for sharing the exciting news from Andhra Pradesh. So we are now reaching the end of our side event, and I would like to take just very few minutes to share some takeaway message. First, as we have heard over the last 2 days and for many months already, our food system are currently facing more and more challenge. I mean, more challenge than ever, actually, with the combined increasing impact of climate change, but also the impact of the input, energy, and food crisis due to the ongoing war in Ukraine. But despite this very bleak situation, it can also provide a window of opportunity to accelerate the promotion and dissemination of integrated and holistic approach such as agroecology. And agroecology, for instance, was recognized during the UN Food System Summit as an important way forward to boost nature-based solution for agriculture and food production. And we can notice that after decades of effort, we are clearly reaching a momentum, and today's event has strongly highlighted the rising interest across the region and beyond. So we can see national, sub-national, and even regional initiatives that are being developed, implemented, and supported by government agencies, research institutions, farmer organizations, and other key stakeholders. And there is an important opportunity to build upon this current wind of change, and to deepen multi-stakeholder dialogue and cooperation to define and refine transformative pathway. But all these initiatives still need to be further strengthened, scaled up, scaled out, documented and promoted. And in that regard, I think that the Agroecology Coalition can play a role, and it can accompany the transformation of food system towards healthier, more resilient, equitable and sustainable system. So to finish, I really would like to warmly thank all our speakers in the room and online, and also all the participants who join us today. And I hope that today's event will encourage you to learn more about the coalition And for those who haven't joined it yet, I mean to join us and to continue this dialogue in order to define what we want to do also in the region with the coalition. Potentially, for instance, to set up a resource center and to gather all the resources that are available in order to support each country or each stakeholders that is engaged in transforming the food system. So thank you very much and have a good day. And I hope we will continue this, this discussion. The sound quality was really bad.
The content
is very good.
Yeah. 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 Really difficult to manage in 1 hour. Really, really presenter.
But here there are over 100 and it's really nice to see you in person. We have interacted many times on the Zoom. And same with and tomorrow evening. So I'm
Pierre will not be able to join either. I mean, in the classic workshop.
Hi,
Estelle. We fit all down together. I'm from the ESL.
Okay.
Nice
meeting in the flesh.
Online.
Good job. Nice having you still.
Sure, yes, me too. So we
I think it's sort of in the last couple of years, isn't it? There's been a sort of move within it, away from, still. A section in FAO which is on agroecology and there's a number of barriers probably so they're there but I think you're right that there's a I think some senior figures are antagonistic and this is something when I had a debate with Ken Gillard, nitrogen fixing scientists from Bangkok.